Ooh, the track record of good taking musicals to film is tough, man.
It's hard.
That's a whole fun conversation to have. It's been done really successfully like 9 times. Mm-hmm. And then it's been done poorly like 187 times. Yeah. Like, you gotta say the best musical to film ever is Sound of Music, right? Grease,
probably.
Maybe?
Grease is, well, I mean, it's like they captured something other than just the show.
Exactly.
That was kind of the genius of them, was that they actually didn't just stick to the show.
You have to.
And,
yeah.
Yeah.
Sound of Music. I, you know, actually, we always do the geek game of what are your top 20 movies. Sound of Music is always on my top 20.
Movie.
I put it like number 6 on
West
my
Side
list.
West Side Story is a great movie.
West Side Story is an amazing movie. For some reason, for me, I go more Sound of Music. I love that they're fighting fascism with music and nature. I just love the underlying, like, sort of subversive, powerful quality to that. Plus, it's like the most beautiful looking movie ever. And then the songs are just great songs. I don't care who you are.
Yeah.
Well, my wife would say West Side Story. She's a massive West Side Story fan, yeah.
Of course, Robert Weisman screwed up Star Trek, so go figure. Not everybody is meant to do everything.
That's hilarious. All right, sir, whenever you're ready.
So the basic drill is to do what we've been doing, which is chatting. I've never hit this pinata before, so I feel like we'll go, you know, don't be surprised that we're not only talking about Big Short.
Anything you want to talk about, yeah.
So, childhood suggested that you would be an improv guy, or were you a funny kid? Were you always wanting to be a funny kid?
Yeah, probably. I could give a more nuanced answer to make myself seem complicated and layered. But yeah, I love comedy from a really young age. My mom is really funny. Like, she used to do the thing of reading the children's stories, and she would change what they're about. And I remember just laughing so hard when I was like in kindergarten, you know. And also, I was lucky to be born in a time where comedy exploded. You know, starting in the 70s with Steve Martin became like the first stand-up who was like a rock star filling arenas, and he was really funny. George Carlin, Monty Python was like a revelatory moment. When I was in second grade, I was living in Worcester, Massachusetts. I saw Monty Python for the first time. I was like, oh my God. So, you know, I grew up in this time where everything's exploding. Then you hit the 80s, and then media is just exploding. Suddenly the amount of TV channels are doubling every year. You know, when I don't know if you remember, when I was a kid, they would put out a new movie like every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden it started becoming a new movie every week. Then it was like 2 new movies every week. Like,
yeah.
So that whole explosion mixed with a love of comedy just kind of went foam to me, like starting to do stand-up comedy when I was in college. And even though I was taking screenwriting classes and I was an English major, I was always doing stand-up on the side. And then the two of those kind of fused into me going to Chicago and doing long-form improv. And
so where were you in school before that?
I went to Temple University in Philadelphia, and it was during the mid-80s when stand-up was just blowing up. Mm. And one of my good friends was actually Paul F. Tompkins, who has had a pretty successful career. There are a few other guys came out of that scene that have done really well. Keith Robinson, about 3 or 4 others I'm forgetting. But it was a good little stand-up scene in like a 6th biggest city in the country at that time. So it was not bad. But then the theater scene in Chicago and long-form improv and Del Close and Upright Citizens Brigade in Second City, that really was where I feel like I found what I was supposed to do. Because it combined writing with performing, with sort of conceptual thinking. And yeah, those were like, how long was I there for? 5, 6 years, some of the most productive creative years of my entire life when I was in Chicago.
So is Upright, I mean, it seems to me like there's an evolution from early Second City and National Lampoon to Groundlings to Upright Citizens Brigade. Certainly on Saturday Night Live, that's been the evolution.
It seems about right to me. I mean, you know, when we came to Chicago, it was all about Del Close, and he was not teaching at Second City. He was at I.O., and he was the guy. So I wanted to study with him, so I didn't do Second City. And we went and saw some of the Second City shows, and they were very kind of cookie cutter. They were doing like, like there's a song here, and then there's a blackout, and then there's a scene. Really talented people working there, but just kind of the format had gotten a little stale. So we kind of just quickly dismissed Second City. And so we started doing long form with Del Close. Mm. And out of that, a group of us got to be really good friends. And we started the Upright Citizens Brigade in like some little coffee shop. Mm. And started doing these crazy shows where, you know, I would advertise my own suicide. And we took the entire audience back to my apartment one time and did like a murder scene in my living room. And on and on and on. We had like Horatio Sanz was in the original cast and he got arrested during a show and we had to like raise bail money to get him out. And it was Chicago. It was like just these wild shows that, you know, anything we thought of, we just did. It was really, really fun. But then I was broke. You know, I still wasn't making any money. I always say like, if you know, the lowest paying jobs in the world are probably like, it's poet, then it's improviser below that. And then right underneath improviser is just lay in a ball and do nothing. It's pretty much, you make no money as an improviser. So Second City was changing. They suddenly were opening their doors a little bit wider. They were more interested in long form improv and some of the newer talent in town. This guy, Kelly Leonard, had taken over as artistic director. And I started hearing like, no, it's cool over there. They're open to messing with stuff. So I don't know, how often can you audition for an improv troupe? And I got in and that turned out to be a great experience. So I got to stay there for a while and did this show called Pinata Full of Bees with John Glazer, Scott Adsit, Rachel Dratch, Jenna Jolowitz, this guy Scott Allman. I'm forgetting someone, I'm sure I am. But anyway, it was an amazing cast. And once again, like really satisfying creatively. And off of that, I got hired for Saturday Night Live.
So was that whole scene kind of like everybody knew each other in all the different groups and hung out, or was it competitive? Or
it was crazy. You know, it. I don't know if that time can ever happen again because of the internet now. Basically, if you wanted to do comedy, and you wanted to do sketch comedy, if you wanted to get on Saturday Night Live, if you wanted to do something like that, you kind of had to go to Chicago. Like Chicago had all the comedy theaters. They had the Second City, they had the IO, they had a theater called The Annoyance that was really successful that Andy Richter came out of, all these talented people, Jill Soloway. There were just theaters everywhere. And then there was regular theaters everywhere. And you could get reviewed. Like we put up our first Upright Citizens Brigade show. We had like 9 people in the crowd in a crappy coffee house. And we got reviewed and we got a great review. And then we had crowds after that. So I feel like we were there right probably at the last moment where physically you had to be there. And so there was this flood of talent that was just insane. It was like Amy Poehler and Tina Fey and Mike Myers had just come out of there and Farley had just come out of there and Tim Meadows had just come out of there and Dave Koechner was with us and Ian Roberts and, you know, Matt Besser and Matt Walsh from Veep. And I literally could just keep going on and on and on. And if they're not a name you know, then they're a writer on a show or they're a director. And it was like out of this scene of probably like 300 to 400 improvisers and actors, like 150 of them are still working as writers and actors. Nia Vardulos, her husband Ian Gomez, Steve Colbert, Amy Sedaris, Steve Carell, like just on and on and on. So it was an amazing time to be there. And yes, everyone did kind of know each other. And if you didn't know each other directly, you were aware of who was doing what shows. And there was a little competition, but like the right dose of it. Amazing, amazing place. I was just back there recently and there's kind of, it's such a strange city. It's like right in the Midwest, but it's this big city with beautiful buildings and like this kind of old working class kind of ethos to it. So it really worked out well that that's where I ended up going.
So when you went to SNL, you did not go as a performer.
I auditioned as a performer. They actually did bring me in to audition. And I sort of knew, like, I don't do impressions. I don't do big characters. Like, I'm more kind of the writer guy who plays himself. So I did my audition. I did an okay audition. I didn't embarrass myself. But when I got off the stage, I had scripts and I handed them to Lauren. I go, I'm a writer too. It was the smartest move I ever made. So I got hired as a writer.
So you've had that experience. You moved on to the movie business. I'm leaping because we only have...
Yeah.
But so now you guys have had the first couple movies that were here. Did you feel like you were on a track, or did you feel like it was like, okay, Hollywood's easy, we're gonna figure this out in a hurry? Or?
Well, initially we definitely didn't think that. You know, initially we couldn't get Anchorman made. Everyone said no to it, and it was tough. And then I always say, God bless Todd Phillips. He cast Farrell in Old School, and that broke him. That was it. And the second he broke in Old School, we got the call saying we want to do Anchorman from DreamWorks. And we did DreamWorks, we did Anchorman, and then we did Talladega Nights at Sony, and we were cooking pretty well. And, you know, still doing rewrites on the side, developing other projects. And then Will and I started a company together, Gary Sanchez Productions, and started producing as well. And yeah, it did. It felt like we were on a track. I never would say Hollywood's easy because it's not, but it felt like we knew what we were doing within our circle, you know, and people trusted us.
So is it a lot to do? I mean, or is it, do you feel like you're on a constantly working, or is there, have you figured out a way to balance? I mean, you also have Funny or Die.
Yes.
Is there a way to balance this out all in your life? Do you just find people you can trust to run each little group, or?
It's the whole trick. You hire good people. I mean, with Funny or Die, we started just with the three of us, and we put up the landlord and got like 50 million hits in like 4 days. But then we were smart. We hired Andrew Steele, who used to be head writer at Saturday Night Live, and we hired this guy, Mike Farah, who's like the Uber producer of Uber producers, and hired this guy, Dick Glover, to be the CEO, and they led us to like 5 more years of like prosperity. And now there's a changeover again. So now Owen Burke has taken over creative head, and this guy Chris Bruss is kind of day-to-day producer, and you know, the internet's constantly changing. So, you know, we chime in with sketches. Like, you know, I wrote a sketch with Owen a couple months back called Donaldo Trumpez, about the Mexican Donald Trump who wants to build a wall to keep out all the drunk college students out of Mexico.
Yes.
And so, you know, we're doing stuff like that, but it's always kind of on the side. And then we do have good producers that work for our company. So a lot of times they'll be overseeing a project, but you know, the final word always comes back to us. And the rule is always like, would this be a movie I would want to see?
Right.
But what's happened through the years more and more is that we're getting out of the comedy genre a little bit more. We started doing like some action films. We've had some indie films that aren't even really strictly comedies. And so it's been opening up, which has been really, really fun, because most of all, we just love movies.
So the purpose of Funny or Die for you guys at this point, for you at this point, is you have an outlet for smaller things, you want to do them, but it sounds like it's kind of a side thing that other people are really managing on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, I'd say that's correct. Yeah, I mean, we're always involved in all the big decisions, but the day-to-day of it is definitely like a really talented team of writers and directors and editors. And, and Owen Burke used to be at Gary Sanchez for a bunch of years, one of the smartest, funniest guys you'll ever meet. So the trick was we had to have someone there who we just trust 100%. And when we got Owen, we knew it was a good changeover.
And in the midst of all the talk about women in show business and film and directing and everything else, Funny or Die does seem to have done, not only hired women to direct, but also done pieces about women, like before everybody was talking about it even. It seemed to be almost a priority, or was that just letting the good stuff come up to the surface?
I mean, we just, you know, because Funny or Die is a place that just looks for talented young people, a lot of talented young people are women. So we get these strong women that come in there that direct and write. And then in addition, we started a branch of Gary Sanchez to support new women, you know, new talent from women, new writers, new directors, because we just felt like it was being like, this is ridiculous. There's so many talented women out here. Like, this could actually be really good business. So that's been going really well. We call it Gloria Sanchez, and Jessica Elbaum runs that. And she's already made a couple movies under that banner and really found some great new talent. So yeah, for us, that argument about the women thing that you, it was like 5 years ago, you know, women aren't good at comedy and stuff. People in comedy know that's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, I can't remember who the guy was that said it. But some big shot said that women, you know, pretty women
some
aren't funny.
Some old big shot. Probably.
Yeah, and I was like, you have no idea what you're talking about. I mean, right now, probably the two biggest comedy stars in the world are Schumer and Melissa McCarthy. So it's like ludicrous to be in the Tina Fey and Amy Poehler. It's just on and on, Sarah Silverman, on and on, these like wickedly funny women. So it seemed very natural with our company and with Funny or Die that we would link up with that.
So is there a sense of, okay, this is where we want to be, or we're moving in this direction, or is it really just a function of what is funny or what you want to do?
Are we talking about Funny or Die or Gary
Everything,
Sanchez?
The whole thing. Yeah.
Gary Sanchez, absolutely, there's an intent. Like we had a company meeting like about what, 7 months ago, I think. And we very specifically talked about where we want to be headed, what we want to be doing. And the goal has always been just to expand the types of films that we can make. That's always been the goal of, you know, I really want to make a horror film. Like, whether I direct it or not, I don't know, but I want to produce like a really cool horror film. And, you know, we've worked on these action movies, and like, I love a good action movie. And like, and yet at the same time, I would love, like, I was really proud of the movie that we did, Welcome to Me, which I thought was a really dark, interesting comedy with Kristen Wiig. So that's basically all it is. And then we'll always do comedies, big commercial comedies. We love them. We're good at them. So, you know, we have Daddy's Home coming out on Christmas Day. Like, that's always part of what we do. But yeah, I just want to make cool stuff. I mean, that's the whole reason you start these companies, because, you know, it's a production company. It's not going to be around for 150 years. It's, you know, we didn't open GE. It's like, it's for us to make stuff. And if it's not stuff that you're challenged by or that you're enjoying or you're proud of, doesn't mean it always works out. There's plenty of times where we go, this is going to be amazing. And then it comes out and you're like, oh, what happened? You know, not as many times as times that it works, which is why we're still in business. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's basically kind of the swing of it. It's just we want to do stuff we love and we're excited by.
So is a Lifetime thing like kind of a giant Funny or Die sketch that became a movie? Is that basically?
Yeah, that's basically
let's
it.
Let's try something we haven't done.
Or? I mean, that was Ferrell and Wig just said, what if we do a Lifetime movie and play it completely straight and never tell anyone it's a joke and just never do any press beforehand and just release it and see what happens? And it was really like a performance art piece is really what it was like. And I don't know if I've ever laughed so hard as reading Twitter the night that that premiered. Just the mixture of confusion and people taking it deadly seriously and then people totally getting the joke. And oh my God, my wife and I laughed for like 2 hours reading that Twitter feed. Mm.
So for yourself, in terms of the projects you take on as director, it seems like there's usually a couple year window between projects. You're not like jamming it out. It sounds like a lot to do on your schedule.
Well, I write too. I usually write what I do. And because of that, I can't just have a script ready to go and then boom. Although I guess some people write what they do and still jam them out every year. I don't know how they do that. But I actually like the 5-6 month break between the movies. Kind of lets you gather yourself, think about what you really want to do. And so, yeah, I've been happy with a movie every 2 years feels about right for me.
So it is kind of like a habitual thing at this point. You kind of have a rhythm to it.
Yeah, well, as long as there's ideas, you know, if there's, it's always got to be an idea that makes me want to get up off my chair and go direct for the next 2 years. So my rule is like, can anyone else direct this? If anyone else can direct it, let's try and get them to do it. And then, you know, if it's so unique to what I do or what Will and I do, then I have to direct it. And then the next question is, am I going to be excited every day to show up for work to make this movie? And, you know, everything I've done to this point, the answer to that has been yes. Like, these are movies I, like, love and can't wait to get to work for. So, I mean, I had a lot of fun writing Ant-Man this past year because it was so cool. Like, I got to write with Paul Rudd. The stuff we wrote, like, Peyton Reed shot beautifully. Like, I went to the premiere. I was like, he knocked it out of the park. I was so happy. I was like, I get how you could just be a writer, but the trick is you got to have good directors shooting your stuff, because I've had the experience the other way where you write something and it's, no, that's not what it was supposed to be. So,
And Peyton gives you guys like complete credit for making that movie work.
Peyton, first off, is the greatest guy ever, but second off, an amazingly talented director. He's giving us too much credit because we wrote some cool stuff, but man, he shot it to the nines and then some. I mean, there's so many cool extra things he put in there. And
but it's a hard position to be in when that whole Edgar thing happened and all that. And
oh, yeah.
That it was... sounds like you guys really kind of resurrected it for Disney also before, and Marvel before he came on board even.
Yeah, that really worked out well. I mean, you know, I love Edgar. We've been friends for a long time, and that was a very tricky situation for me too. So. But also I love Marvel. I grew up on Marvel and really like Kevin Feige a lot. So it was, we ended up coming up with a great solution, which was that Paul and I write the script and Peyton direct. And it was like, turned out perfectly. So that was such a pleasurable experience. So I at the same time, sometimes may just write a script and then have someone else shoot it, which is pretty enjoyable as well. So we'll see. We'll see what comes along.
So does Paul have another career coming as a writer director? Or
Paul's a good writer. Paul's a really good writer. You know what Paul's really good at is dialogue. Like, he's really good. And he's meticulous on story, too. Like, we did some big story switches on that script. And they're, like, that whole ending with the microverse was, like, I think that was initially, I had some idea about what if you go subatomic, and then he had the idea of where to put it. But, like, he was right with that, man. And that was some story mechanics to make that thing work. It's annoying because he never ages. He's incredibly good looking. He's really funny. He has the best taste in music. He loves his family. But on top of it, he is a legitimately good writer. Mm. Yeah.
What's interesting, because I do think I think what works about that movie, and I think kind of is pretty much what works about a lot of your films, is this kind of joy that's underneath of it that doesn't get cynical or distracted or whatever. I mean, it's not silly.
Yeah.
It's not like,
yeah.
you know, hee-hee, but it's... There's a real pleasure that you feel in the work in almost all the films.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I would say if you were gonna, you know, pin me with a signature kind of move, I would say that would definitely be it. As I like to have, I'm a big believer. I talk about movies in terms of energy, and you know, not in a sort of crystal new age way, but just as far as what is it doing to me as an audience member, whether I'm laughing or not. To me, it's all about the rhythms of energy and like changing tones, and and there's a time to really push, and then there's a time where. And I just always look at movies that way. And it's, and you know, you don't want to be pushed the entire time. You know, you want things to be funny sometimes, joyful sometimes, Jeopardy sometimes. But that change in tones, as we're seeing genres break down more and more, I don't think the genres really hold anymore. Those changes in tone become like key to screenwriting and directing, I think, at this point.
So was directing scary when you started doing it?
No, I mean, the reason I loved it was the very first time I sat in the director's chair, I was like, I like this, which I don't know what that says about me. I enjoyed that power that much. But I remember it was a short I did at Saturday Night Live called Neil Armstrong, The Ohio Years. And I remember just sitting down on the set, and I had written it and everything was there. And I was like, this is cool. I was telling someone recently that it really what it is you're up at 2 a.m. You're thinking of these crazy ideas. You have this idea. You write it on a page, and then you flash forward to 4 months later where the world's greatest professionals in their profession have made your crazy idea look amazing and perfect and fully come to life. And it's like a magic trick. It's like every time it happens, I'm never tired of it. Like writing that Brick Tamlin is going to kill a guy with a trident on a horse. And I show up on set, and there's a trident, and there's a stuntman on a horse, and we do it, and it looks pretty damn good. And then there's a guy on fire. I've just never, and even with a movie that's more of a drama like The Big Short, it's the same thing. I mean, seeing, you know, Christian Bale transform into that character, going from our initial discussions to him on set, and then seeing what Clayton Hartley did with the production design and how Barry's shooting it, it's a charge I never, ever get over.
See, I think it was actually the greatest thing about Saturday Night Live that still kind of stuck with me since I was there as a small child was that that window of how that happening in 5 days.
And amazing.
Seeing it on air on Saturday night and seeing it happen and knowing it was over was something glorious about that, too.
Insane. And then, I mean, I just remember one night, like, Farrell and I are up. It's like 4 a.m. and someone tells us Robert Duvall's going to, like, do a guest appearance. Like, he's not the host. And we're like, we got to write something with you and Robert Duvall. Like, Farrell goes, I wouldn't mind gently brushing his cheek, gently caressing his cheek. And I just go, I wouldn't mind hearing you sing Lay Lady Lay to him. And boom, we just wrote this sketch where he's a male nurse who, while he's changing his bedpan, sings Lay Lady Lay to him. And like 4 days later, it's on national television going out to people. And Farrell and I are like, what the hell just happened?
And I'm sure Duvall's still saying the same thing.
Oh, he was a good sport, but yeah. Oh, yeah. And I mean, I never get tired of that. It's just the most incredible thing.
So, Big Short, where did the first notion of it come to you?
It's just honestly the book. I mean, I've always loved Michael Lewis. He did something with the storytelling I just hadn't seen before, where he fused these incredible characters that I just immediately was drawn in by, sympathetic to, that were heartbreaking, that were funny. And he fused them with this information that they learn as you go through the book that without being connected to the characters, ordinarily it would be very dry and very boring. But because the information's living through the characters about this collapse, I found myself completely understanding the collapse. I mean, not completely, but getting a really good picture of it while being completely drawn in by these characters. And it was just this odd combination of information and character that you see it in mysteries or thrillers, but usually the information's made up. But to have it be this real cataclysmic event that I only knew just a little bit about, it just got me really excited when I was done with the book.
And so the form of the book was not intimidating. It was actually what drew you in.
100% what drew me in. Everyone says, oh my God, how can you do that as a movie? That's exactly what I loved about it, was that he had fused the information with the characters. So I kind of knew right away. It was like, you got to break the fourth wall. You got to break the number one rule of filmmaking, which is show, don't tell. You have to break that rule. And I thought, there's a way to do it. There's a clever way to do this. These characters are so strong that I think you can jump away from them for a little bit and go back, and they'll still be that emotional energy in the tank. So I thought of my theater background from Chicago, you know, breaking the fourth wall, which is something we did do. And I thought of movies that it's successfully done it, like 24 Hour Party People to me is like, that's a masterpiece. I love that movie. And I've just seen it done, and I've seen it work. That was my immediate idea when I pitched to Plan B and to Dee Dee Gardner and Jeremy Kleiner was, you got to open this movie up. This movie has to surprise you at every turn. It can't be a traditional narrative. It's got to be having a conversation with the audience. And I pitched them these ideas of like pop culture icons giving us the information, like, because, you know, I wanted pop culture to kind of flow through the movie as far as what was distracting us. And yeah, it was one of those great times where you're just like, ah, I think I know what to do with this.
So they own the they own the book?
They had bought the rights to the book, was it like, what, 4 years ago
instantly,
or something?
Instantly, probably.
Yeah, instantly. You're 100% right. Yeah, and then Charles Randolph had written a really nice draft for it when I came in, and he's like, well, you have this draft, but it's kind of stalled, and I read it, and I was like, this is pretty damn good. Like, Charles can really write. So the script I ended up doing was a fusion of Charles's script and mine. And I was joking with Charles how it really became a chocolate peanut butter kind of thing. The two combined very well. This sort of energetic opening up the movie that I did with some rewriting of characters and scenes and mixed with the brilliant dialogue and characterizations he had done really ended up just oddly fitting together kind of beautifully.
And you had no urge to call Michael Winterbottom, I assume.
I have been praising 24 Hour Party People in almost every single interview I've done, so I wonder if he's heard it at all. But I'm also just a big fan of his across the board, too, not even just 24 Hour Party People. I love kind of everything that guy does.
Yeah. Well, he's a kind of improv-y guy in an interesting way.
Yeah. I've heard people have said that we should meet, that we would hit it off, actually. Yeah. But who knows?
We either hit it off or want to kill each other.
Exactly.
So you went through this process. You're pitching to Brad and Dee Dee.
Right.
Which is weird for you, or does it feel, is that not the norm? I assume that's not the norm for you.
First meeting is with Dee Dee and Jeremy. Yeah. I give them my whole take on it, and they're, you know, it's a pretty bold approach, and God bless them, they're like, oh.
But is it odd as a producer to be going into another set of producers to pitch yourself?
Nah, I do that all the time. That's like, there's other movies that sometimes other people have the rights, and you got to go around and do the pitch thing, even though you're a producer. It happens a lot. I mean, I'm probably not as sharp at pitching as I used to be. I used to be pretty decent at it, but now I'm probably a little fuzzier with it. But it worked well enough. And then I had met with Brad Pitt about another project we were developing years before, a script by Jesse Armstrong about Lee Atwater. So they kind of knew I had political leanings, political, but they knew that I cared about the world at large and wanted to do something commenting on kind of where America is and how we got here. So it was great. They weren't that surprised that I was interested and actually were quite excited.
And the casting at that, is casting the next thing you think about, or had you thought about casting even?
I mean, whenever I write, I always think about, the casting, because you want to have like kind of a tone in mind. So I had like a little cork board next to the computer with kind of my dream cast. So while I was writing the script, you just kind of check in, and I just had some faces there. And so I finished the script, and Paramount was like, hey, this is really cool. Like, they liked it. Mm-hmm. And Plan B was, like, really excited about it. Like, oh, we think this is special. We think this is different. So it was great. I was getting support. But, you know, they started giving me development notes. And you know how that can go. That can last, like, a year, 2 years. So I said, well, I go, obviously it needs a little bit of work, but do you care if I send it to some of my dream cast people? And they were like, well, who are your dream cast people? And I was like, Christian Bale, Ryan Gosling, Steve Carell. And at that time, Brad hadn't committed to acting in it yet. And they didn't quite laugh in my face, but I think they were like, knock yourself out. And that was when, like, within a week and a half, we got yeses from all these people. And then we heard Brad wanted to be in it. And then we had Marissa Tomei and Melissa Leo and just this, you know, murderer's row of actors. It was just unbelievable. So at that point, then we were, as soon as we got that budget, we were greenlit.
So given your other films, are these serious actors, quote unquote? Is that intimidating to you all to deal with, you know, at all, to think about having Christian Bale to manage in some way?
I mean, the first day he walks on set, it's pretty exciting. It's a little intimidating, but you know what you learn pretty quickly? It's the same language we all talk. You know, the language is, you know, listen, collaborate, be honest, be grounded. I mean, it's all those rules apply. And the other thing with this group of actors, these aren't guys who got famous because of some, you know, their hair color or something. They got famous because they're really good actors. So they all kind of knew this language. Now, obviously, I know Carell really well. Gosling I had met with too, and we had kind of hit it off. So I was pretty cool with him, really. And Pitt I had met with. So really the guy I didn't really know was Christian Bale. And we just ended up having the best time. It was just so much fun. And he, of course, blew me away every day with this characterization he did, this character that he created. But most of all, just really collaborative and just really grounded. And you know, we ended up laughing quite a bit together. And I would work with him anytime. That was just a pleasure.
So how do you approach as a director? I mean, are you looking to kind of set the stage and then have the person do the work? Or are you wanting to have long conversations about every detail about the character? What is your...
So, you know, the first thing I do, we'll use Christian Bale as the example because he was the guy I didn't know as much. So I just told him, I go, look, here's how I work. I, you know, come from this improv background. I'm not going to be doing as much of that on this, but I will be doing a little bit. Mm-hmm. And so basically what I have is I have a microphone, but I don't yell into it. It's very low key. It's very calm. Mm-hmm. And there'll be times where occasionally I'll say, hey, try this line, or what if you did this? I go, if that doesn't work for you, let me know and we'll come up with another way. He goes, no, that should be fine. And then I said, the way I like to do it is I like to do, you know, two or three takes, and then I'm going to come and check in with you and kind of see how we're feeling. I just went down the whole thing, and he was completely cool with everything I said. And so, yeah, the way I do it is I get a couple takes just to, usually it's the wider shots where you kind of rehearse and, mm-hmm. you know, everyone loosens up. And then it's usually about that third or fourth take, suddenly they're, you know, the pan's boiling a little bit. And now I'm really looking at it. And also with the way Barry Aykroyd shoots too, the coverage is changing every time. So I'm kind of tracking that as well. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, walk out on set while they're doing a reload and kind of talk to Christian. How are you feeling? It's like, yeah, you know, I don't know, maybe on this one, try, you know, maybe there's too much of the stuttering on this one. It feels like he might be more focused on this. So we're just kicking around intentions. What would Dr. Burry be thinking here? Mm. And kind of just trying stuff on for size. I mean, the great thing with Bale is he's become the character. So anything he does is grounded and stated. So it's all just really about where the character's focus is. It's kind of what you're dealing with him for the most part.
So, okay, so the process in which he comes to you with that character, I mean, is he just, he has a script and he comes to you with a character, or is there conversation before that?
Yeah, we spoke quite a bit. We talked, I was encouraging him to go to the real person, and because I know there's nothing better than the specifics of a real person, he agreed. But we both agreed we weren't going to be trapped by any of it. If there was anything that threw him off, he had the room to kind of play. And he hit it off with Dr. Burry right away. I mean, they hung out for like 14 hours. Mm. Dr. Burry gave him some of his clothes, and like they got really, really close. And then so we would speak, and he would talk about just how he's seeing the character. And I would give him my impression of the character from talking to Dr. Burry. And I'd go, I see him like this. And I think that, you know, what's difficult for a guy like this is, you know, he is on the spectrum. So the world is painful sometimes. So he needs the comfort of the numbers because there's an order to that, and he's safe there. And Bale would go, oh, that's interesting, you know. But I also think he likes that sometimes, you know, we would just have these discussions. Mm-hmm. And then when he showed up on set, that's the first time we did a camera test. Then he kind of like showed the whole shebang, like, here he is. Like for the first time, I'm seeing him walk in front of me. And it was like, holy crap, this is amazing. And then after like a couple scenes, like a couple takes in the first scene, you could see it kind of rev up. And then suddenly it was like, he's the guy. Mm-hmm. And it was incredible. And then every take you do with him, he's the guy. Like, and Carell had that too. Carell really did. And then Jeremy Strong too. Those three I felt like really became the people.
Mm. And so Ryan, do you just say, you go be Ryan Gosling? Or what, no, we think Ryan Gosling is? Or
well, we had different approaches for those guys. What we said with Ryan is don't do a strict impression of the guy, but get a little bit of the vibe, and you're going to be the narrator. You're going to be inside and out of the movie, so I don't want you to feel like you have to be doing this guy. So it's sort of like loosely inspired by him. Mm-hmm. And then he sort of put together, he used some pieces of the real guy mixed with some choices he made. And then the younger guys, John Majerro and Finn Wittrock, I cast them because they're a lot like the real guys. And then they met with them, so they had some of that going on. So everyone's in the ballpark of the real people. But the three that just really like burrowed down were like Carell, Bale, and Jeremy Strong. Or like, if you squinted your eyes, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference between the real person and them. It's really freakish.
So when it's cooking, when you're onto number six or seven, it sounds like, do you just feel it? Do you just know?
Yeah. Yeah, well, I get really excited. I just get like, oh, this is good. Like, I'm just an exuberant guy. So it'll be about seven things lining up. You know, Barry Ackroyd operating the A camera, this guy Josh operating the B camera. Obviously, the actor in the scene are everything, but you're trying to get the right coverage. You're trying to get that performance to line up. There's also background stuff happening. There's screens a lot of times. There's timing issues with that, and I'm just waiting for that like shot that Ackroyd's gonna frame that's like beautiful when Carell nails the exact right take, and then you almost want to jump up and down when it happens. Mm. And then of course the first thing you say is, let's do it again.
So you're the audience at that point.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
And a happy audience.
And a very happy audience. And it's funny, Barry Ackroyd's so stoic that when I would talk to him, I would just always be like, Barry, that was amazing. He'd be like, all right then, should we move on, next setup? I go, but Barry, did you see this shot? Oh, yeah, turned out quite nice.
So did it feel different, significantly different, or different at all from other films you'd have made?
Yeah, I mean, the comedy thing, you know, we don't just make comedies, we make comedies that are like made for audiences to roar with laughter. So you're really pushing the jokes the whole time. And so your mind is going all day long. I'm trying to think of alts and riffs and jokes. And so is the cast. And there's this constant back and forth. It's exhausting is what it is. So by the end of the day, I'm like really tired. And I think as I get older too, I get a little more tired from it. This was like a different kind of creative search that was going on. It was almost one of the ones where like it was in your peripheral vision. You were just looking for this kind of special thing. I mean, we had some of the best filmmakers in the world around us as far as camera people, lighting, all that kind of stuff, and the actors, obviously. So it was always just very kind of these small little things that would line up that you almost wanted to be quiet just to, you know, just to let it kind of happen. But equally as satisfying, no question about it. Less exhausting, but you definitely had to listen a lot more. There's a lot more just listening, which I loved. I thought it was an incredible experience.
Does it change how you think you'll make your next film, or is it a different form in some ways?
It definitely is going to change whatever I do next, whether it's a comedy or another, you know, more dramatic leaning movie. I don't think I'd ever go back to just traditional proscenium shooting and coverage. I just fell in love with that handheld style so much. But once again, the story kind of tells you what you need to do, so I can't even really predict. I could now, like a year from now, see you and tell you, like, guess what? I'm doing a proscenium traditional because the story begs for it, you know? So we'll see what the story is, but there's no question after this, I will definitely lean towards this kind of impressionistic style. I just loved it so much.
And what is post like on a picture like this? I mean, there are the two versions of Anchorman 2 out there. So
yes.
Obviously there was a lot to go through. Is this a little bit more clear when you get into post?
You're never thinking of another version. You're not thinking of anything, but it's far from clear. I mean, it was an elaborate movie to put together. I was very lucky to have Hank Corwin, who's one of the world's great editors. And there are a lot of layers of discussion and talking, and we wanted to show the outside world, so we used some stock footage, and yet we had these explanations of the financial esoterica, so we had to get that in there, and then you had the character ensemble story, and we wanted to have just clips of videos and kind of ephemera from our white noise culture that was also on top of that. And so all of it, it felt like a constant calibrating process where we would just screen it and like take this down a little bit, take this up, take this down, cut this, bring this in. And it was just all, I kept thinking of like just dough where you're just trying to get it into the right shape. And then finally one day we had it in the right shape and we played it for a test audience and it was like they connected with it. I was like, all right, I think we got it. You know?
Were you getting other voices for like friends and stuff in the midst of all that, or were you really the two of you?
We did a couple early screenings with like six people in the room, eight people in the room. Those are tough though. Those are hard. Unless the people are all filmmakers, it's so hard for someone to look at a 2-hour, 45-minute cut of a film and go, oh, you need, like, you just can't help it. You have an impression, you have a, a muscular response to seeing a 2-hour, 45-minute movie that became a 2-hour movie. It's just so different. So I used to do a lot of friends and family screenings. I don't do them as much anymore. I don't find them very helpful. Now I like the recruited ones, the NRG ones, and just give me 70 people, give me 150 people, and just put it up and sit in the middle of them and see how it feels.
And without as many laughs, or is it the same experience?
Absolutely. Yeah, you can feel the energy of the crowd. It doesn't matter if there's laughs or not. It's, you know how it is. You're in a crowd. You can feel the energy. It doesn't matter if you hate hockey and you're at a hockey game, you're in that crowd, you're part of the energy. So I mean, that was really helpful with this movie, because this movie does sort of have a conversation with the crowd.
Well, it's funny because the screenings have become so kind of notoriously irritating in some ways, partially because of the cards, I guess. But, you know, people like Coppola and those who've always done test screenings, always been critical to their filmmaking, but they just weren't as focused on cards and what the marketing aspect was.
I hardly look at the cards. I glance. They give you these numbers and I'll kind of just half listen to them. It's all for me about sitting in that crowd. That's what it's all about. Sometimes, you know, you get into a tricky logic hole, and sometimes those cards can help, or the focus group can help you a little bit. And sometimes it's good to hear in the focus groups, just people respond. But I don't like when it becomes a grade. I think that's when it's bad, when it starts being like, oh, your number's not high enough. I'm thinking, all right, that's no longer helpful. But just for feeling the movie playing, it's the best. I love test screenings.
So when you get the movie done and they say, hey, let's move this into award season, intimidating at all? Is that...
I was partially responsible for that. I was the one who went to them and said, hey, I think we got this done sooner than we thought. I actually think this is one of those rare cases where we kind of knew what we were doing. So I invited them very early to come see it. And there was a lot of people telling me, don't do that. You haven't even delivered your director's cut yet. Why would you invite the studio? I was like, I think we got it. I think the spine's there. And sure enough, they showed up. It was like Brad Gray, Rob Moore, Megan, everyone was there. And they agreed. They're like, yeah, you got something here. And so at that point, we kind of went into a little bit of hyperdrive, but I knew we had it. I wasn't worried. I knew there wasn't reshoots. It was all going to just be choices. And we had a really good young composer who had already dialed into a sound. I knew I had this amazing editor. And then our sound team that came on, the early dubbed sound team with Becky Sullivan, and then Anna and Terry for the final mix were just so freaking good that, like, we had the A team. And so I knew we could pull it off.
So are you enjoying this process now?
Here's what I've learned through this process. It's tiring, there's no question. But what I've learned is I definitely love this movie. And I'm not tired of talking about it yet, which that's impressive given how much I've talked about it. So it's a lesson for me, like, in the future, make movies with a lot of meat to them, because then you can go and talk about them a lot. Whereas, you know, sometimes when we do our comedies, they just ask me like 6 questions over and over again. So did you crack up on set? How funny is Will Ferrell? How much do you improvise? Over and over and over. But this one's actually, you know, it's about a bunch of stuff. And we've had some amazing Q&As for it, and some amazing just people coming up to us after screenings and interviews. And so, yeah, thank God we like the movie.
And do you have emotional weight to whether this gets nominations, or how many nominations and how much box office and all of that? Or is that...
I want it to play. Oh, no, I do. I want it to play. So whether that's box office or awards helping box office or awards showing that the movie is connecting, whatever it is, I just want the people to see the movie. So the awards matter. You know, the awards do. I mean, when you get those nominations, like, it's a little signature on the film that, hey, some respectable people thought this was worth seeing. So we were excited when we got those Golden Globe nominations from the HFP. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we want people to see the movie. I mean, we don't expect it to, you know, make $1 billion worldwide, but if just in some way it could spur the conversation in our country, I would be delighted.
And could you ever imagine this would be where you were at 47 years old?
I mean, I think I always knew I was going to make movies. That didn't surprise me too much. But I don't think I ever thought I'd be sitting on this movie, this particular movie. I always knew I would do something serious or different. But this, who would have ever guessed it was a Michael Lewis book and it was about this, and that we would make this kind of movie? No, I would never guess the specifics of this.
But the big picture for you, I mean, you're a mogul, you have a chunk of Hollywood and you have enormous success in all kinds of ways.
Judd Apatow was just here a little while ago. He's a mogul. I'm not quite a mogul. I'm doing quite well. I can't complain. I love what I get to do. But But yeah, I mean, you know, the trick I always say is that I just love movies. It's kind of like I love basketball, and I will watch high school basketball, I will watch college, I will watch pro, I will watch foreign games. It doesn't matter. I love basketball, though I'm not crazy about the college game right now. But that's the way I am with movies. I love movies. I mean, one of my favorite movies of this past year was It Follows, which was a horror film. And it's just all kinds of movies, like Babadook blew me away. It's another horror film. Kung Fu Hustle is one of my all-time favorite movies. I don't even know what to call that. Like, so the idea that maybe now, you know, I can do more varied movies is like really exciting for me. I mean, that's definitely the personal gain of this is, oh my God, I could try some other stuff, you know.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate
it. My pleasure, man.
Thanks.
Great talking with you.
And you.